Último agradecimiento que no puedo dejar de hacer a Francisco Crespo y Antonio Lara, que desde la Fundación han un poco trabajado junto con RAC en este ciclo. El ciclo, como sabéis, es sobre jóvenes arquitectos, que o bien han tenido relación con Andalucía en general, un poco con España, siendo de fuera, o bien siendo de aquí, pues han tenido mucha relación con el exterior. Nos parecía importante organizar este ciclo porque nos parece también que quizás dentro del mundo más joven pues hay también una gana de interpretar la profesión no solamente de nivel profesional sino también a tener un poco de investigación. Y creo que un poco la selección que al final se ha producido, aunque muchos hayan quedado fuera, pues un poco demuestra esa actitud de investigación en la arquitectura, cosa que siempre nos viene un poco bien, ¿no?, a los arquitectos. Antes de dejar la palabra para la presentación, solo quería decir que esta sí es la última conferencia, pero la intención de la Fundación, que un poco se habló también al principio, no era solo hacer un ciclo de conferencias reducido en un ámbito espacial y temporal, sino intentar interpretar esta como una primera actividad hacia una especie de observatorio de la joven arquitectura que se irá produciendo en los próximos años, con la intención de cada año hacer en distintas ciudades, con distintos actores, esta especie de encuentro que sí nos ve aquí reunido, por lo que evidentemente agradecemos a todos la presencia, pero que sí, como sabéis, tiene un contenedor virtual en el que se van colgando todas las conferencias, las grabaciones, se van enlazando las páginas web de los conferenciantes, y de alguna forma ese va siendo ya un primer contenedor como observatorio que trasciende un poco los límites de nosotros estar aquí, ¿no? Y de hecho pues está teniendo bastante difusión y de alguna forma creemos que en un mundo además joven pues de alguna forma pueda tener más visibilidad que en cambio este momento, aun siendo importante de cercanía, que puede ser un importante lugar de encuentro mucho más allá del ámbito español, ¿no? En ese sentido pues creo que la Fundación, me tomo esta responsabilidad, creo que la Fundación sí tendrá gana y voluntad los años futuros de ya reproducir esta experiencia, pero ya con esa visión de observatorio de la joven arquitectura contemporánea. Pues os agradezco mucho haber estado aquí y os invito una vez más, para los que no han podido estar en Córdoba, a ver las conferencias de Córdoba, como sabéis, mitad en Córdoba, mitad en Sevilla. Y una vez más, gracias a RAC y a Francisco y Antonio, y dejo la palabra de la presentación, y gracias por estar aquí. Aunque no te parece mucho a Patricia.
Pues en nombre de RAC, me tocaba presentar al estudio Juan B. Medina. Pedimos disculpas, tanto tú como yo, por yo estaba planeado que viniera Patricia, que era un poco la conexión del estudio con el ciclo que estamos organizando, ¿no? Un poco de que tenga que ver con el sur, como bien ha dicho Dario. Pero bueno, yo creo que no hay un problema con que me acuerdo, más aún lo hacemos un poquito más extenso en la geografía en la que hemos estado trabajando y mejor. Yo, de todas formas, antes de presentarlos a ellos, voy a dar solo a todos los que quería, pues, también incluir en la misma idea que os ha comentado Gaya, comentar cómo que todo este tipo de conferencias, ¿no? Desde que nos empezamos a reunir los cuatro que formamos RAC, que lo que queríamos, lo que sentíamos es que había una falta de un espacio donde pudiéramos con cierta facilidad conocer la arquitectura un poco que más cercana es de nuestra generación, ¿no? Como hemos dicho en muchas otras presentaciones, es fácil acceder a la arquitectura que hacen gente que ya está un poco más asentada, que tiene más posibilidad de publicar, pero no había un foro, al menos lo sentíamos así, sobre todo en Sevilla, que está un poco en Andalucía, donde podíamos tener este contacto, ¿no? Por eso nos parece interesante pues, promoverlo, ¿no? Y bueno, fue un poco la idea base que se ha materializado en este caso, como bien ha dicho Gaya, en este pequeño ciclo de 8 conferencias, que muy bien nos han servido además de trabajar con la Fundación para que se haya hecho en Sevilla y en Córdoba, lo cual yo creo que empieza a hablar también de la idea de transferencia que hemos venido, con la que hemos, digamos, hilado todo el ciclo. Y que bueno, la pretensión, tanto como la Fundación como nuestra, es que esto no sea, que digamos que el ciclo conferencia es un ejemplo más de esta intención, que podría tener otro formato en otro caso, seguramente tendrá también seguro otras fechas y otros nombres. Y dentro de los nombres, pues bueno, decir simplemente que ya que estamos en la última conferencia, nos hemos dado cuenta, es una pequeña conclusión que hemos sacado desde DACO, un pequeño sentimiento que, digamos, la idea de transferencia que tenía que ver un poco con la geografía, donde cada uno ha nacido, donde cada uno ha sido educado, o ha trabajado, o trabaja actualmente, que un poco por qué la selección de ese grupo de arquitectos. También ha tenido mucho que ver dentro de las propuestas que cada uno de ellos nos ha mostrado, ¿no? Pues desde el primer día de la primera conferencia en Córdoba, un poco la propuesta fresca y un poco radical de Miguel Urbán, desde la arquitectura, hasta a lo mejor el amor por el detalle y por la construcción que nos presentaron Pablo y Sara, de Corporación de Arquitectos, la investigación en temas de ordenadores, parámetros, etcétera, de datos de información de ópera, de Carlos Infante, que estuvo aquí, en fin, hemos tenido, yo creo que eso que nos une, que es la generación, además, lo interesante es que hemos visto un panorama muy amplio de ejemplos muy distintos de cómo cada uno hace su carrera, ¿no? Bueno, en este caso, ya para concretar, hoy tenemos con nosotros a Kurt, que representa a Fambelle Medina Architects. Ellos son una firma internacional en el sentido de que tienen base en Bélgica y en Málaga. Bueno, como sabéis, él es socio de lo profesional y lo sentimental de Patricia Medina y es un poco por lo que tiene las dos bases, ¿no? Bueno, simplemente yo quería dar unos datos biográficos y a lo mejor de profesión para introducir, porque ellos nos contarán ampliamente su obra. Fambelle Medina comienza casi cuando los dos están trabajando para Claus Mecán Arquitecten, donde pasan varios años de profesión, una vez Patricia antes de acabar y después de acabar, y pues, cuando ya había acabado de su carrera, y es donde un poco surge o empieza el germen de la oficina, ¿no? Como sabéis, Claus Mecán Arquitecten está basado en Holanda, ellos embargo tienen ahora la oficina en Bélgica, que es donde es Kurt. Y bueno, digamos que comienza también la oficina una vez gana en el Europa, en lo que están todavía trabajando muy duramente, a ver si son capaces de sacarlo adelante, saben todo lo difícil que es materializar los concursos en el Europa en edificios, que es lo que están ellos muy interesados. Y aparte de eso, la mayor parte de todo el trabajo que están desarrollando son concursos, y son aquí lo que están construyendo son concursos ganando, lo cual para mí, como también ha dicho Ayan, me parece que es un reflejo de la investigación que continuamente desarrollan en la oficina, ¿no? Tienen prácticamente cero en trabajo privado y todo lo que están construyendo, que también tienen cuatro edificios de construcción, son todos a partir de concursos, ¿no? Bueno, aparte del Grupam, por destacar que bueno, en marzo van a haber un concurso de viviendas que se llama Priestess Dale.
Es la última, sí.
El último concurso que han ganado. En marzo y un poco la dinámica que llevan, ¿no? Trabajan continuamente haciendo concursos como intentando materializar lo que ya ganaron algunos años antes, ¿no?
Okay.
Bueno, concretamente Kurt, además de su actividad profesional de estudio, es profesor de máster en Holanda, de nuevo, profesor aquello de las transferencias, él ha sido profesor invitado en Barcelona, en Granada también, en Maastricht, antes de ser profesor. Y yo creo que es interesante porque me estaba contando antes que él está en la unit que dirige Tony Fredlund, y frente a un poco esa idea que tenemos de la arquitectura holandesa, en Maastricht están intentando...
Está en TU Delft.
En Delft. Bueno, sí. Me refiero a que un poco enfrente de esa idea de arquitectura holandesa, basada en los conceptos, ¿no? Porque bueno, antes, ellos están intentando desarrollar algo que sea mucho más dedicado a la construcción de edificios, ¿no? A la construcción de ideas. Y me parece que también tiene que ver un poco con lo que nos va a mostrar ahora de su obra aquí.
Ok, muchas gracias. Primero, muchas gracias por la invitación a la organización y por tu palabra, José, por la introducción. Como José dice, esta noche está no solo una conferencia, pero también después está un poco una discusión o una comunicación con el público y concluir la serie de conferencias. Y para mí está también interesante porque yo soy belgo, trabajo en Amberes, Holanda, y también un poco en España. Yo tengo también la interés, tenemos un diálogo después. Por la presentación, a lo mejor yo pienso está un mezcla de español e inglés. Yo a lo mejor la base está en inglés y yo cambio un poco. A lo mejor la presentación está en inglés y después, o cuando tú tienes preguntas, por favor, pregunta a mí. Está baja, ok. Voilà. The title, Work in Process. When we were asked to participate in this lecture, or when you have to prepare a lecture, you are not only looking to your projects which are actual in the office, but you're also making a reflection. By the way, everybody is understanding me good? You're also making a reflection for yourself, like how we are working, what are the themes, what are the reflections in our projects. So in this way, we make the kind of analyze to start up or to start assembling this lecture together. But second also, as Jorge introduced, is the way how we work or the process in our studio, how we receive these projects. I will say 99%, but it's almost 100% by competitions, not direct commissions. This is effect also. This has also been a direct influence how you work. And the day you decide to make a competition, only after 3, 4, 5 years, you are discovering what is the input. The day you decide to make a competition is to select a competition for maybe the ambition in architectural quality, the graphical location, the urban qualities. But later on, you discover which is the background of this competition, and often you see that these commissions are public commissions, dealing with totally other regulations which you were never focused by as a young office. So in this way, the office is existing almost 4 or 5 years, and finally next week we have the first next week, in 2 weeks, the 16th of June, it's a super important day. We're going to sign the first contract with a contractor to start build. By other hand, the good thing is when you start commissions, you are selecting your own portfolio, your own portefeuille. So the first building we're going to start building is also immediately 6,000 square meter, which I will show this evening. But before, I want to give a small introduction, and this three pictures which I selected, Spain, the Netherlands and Belgium, are the three countries we are working, or we are trying to work. And in fact, it was more a selection, a reduction of three pictures of these different landscapes. When you see the first one is un mercado. Yo creo está no, a lo mejor está en Málaga, no lo sé, o Sevilla, está un imagen de un internet. No, but it's showing, is in fact for me reflecting how I'm reading the urban activity in Spain. And of course for you this is nothing new, but when we are coming here como un extranjero, como se llama en Granada, como un guiri. Now the public life in street is totally different, and in this way, for me it's always amazing when I go back and you're sitting in the plane, you're reflecting how social public life, social life, but also that the activity in the street is for us fascinating and always one of the first criteria to start, especially when we're looking to Spanish project. The second image is an image, the houses are made by Patricia, but in and it's in the in Vlissingen, it's by the Dutch border, in the near the North Sea, the in front of the sea, and it's in fact a kind of question like how you deal with the Dutch landscape, and in this way the Netherlands they have this tradition of rebuilding their landscapes since, as you know, in 1953 they have this big problem with water, so they by geographical condition they have the need to reinforce their landscape, to protect themselves from water. And the last image is a typical image which you can discover in, let's say, 50% of all the Flemish gardens. But what I want to say, in fact, with these three pictures, and when you combine them together, is the scale or the last Belgian picture, how the Belgian persons are maybe only interested in their own back garden and also not looking farther than their own back garden. How the Netherlands is treating with landscapes, and in this way I think also have a really good vision about landscaping and open space and treating in this way scale. To build one house in the Netherlands, I think it's not existing. Our smallest project or smallest commission we have now in the Netherlands is 33 houses. And the last one is this Mercado. Maybe it's also reflecting only the Spanish culture of eating. So when you're here, beside working, I think half of the day you are also thinking, what are we going to eat this evening? I think there was paella this evening? Or there is paella this evening. I explained to you the system of competitions. And to do a competition is fun. To win a competition is even not that difficult. But then it starts. Often, to build a competition, you have to win them two or three times. And this we discovered often. We have now, we are doing, let's say, around 16 competitions a year. There was one year we won 6 of these 16, and we have now from this 6 competition 1. So it's one, let's say it's 1/20th of 5% of the actual competitions you start is becoming a really project. So I think this is also telling something about the offers you have to bring as an architect making competitions. This will explain itself during the lecture, and I think it's more a theme of after the discussion. As I told you, we were analyzing, and what I show you this evening is, as I told, we're gonna start finally building our projects. What I will show you this evening is not a summary of project, but is we selected 5 chapters. And within these chapters, we are focusing on different themes of our projects. And this is in one time also reflecting a little bit the discussion I had in the beginning with José. I'm a teacher in Delft. And Delft, or the Netherlands, is still known. And these books in the library, you see them immediately, this gray with these yellow letters, OMA and Winnie Maas. This system of one concept, and that's making the building. In fact, what we are trying is, and we are often not speaking about concepts, but what we are trying is to make buildings with maybe 10 or 20 ideas. And I think for us, this the richness and the quality of a designing process is not based in one concept, but in the several ideas. And the several ideas which are at the end assembling the final result of this competition, and finally you start building them after developing them. And as the last part is in fact In Dutch, this booklet it called is a boekje of Nijntje. And Nijntje is a small word of konijntje, konecho. I think here in Spain you know these books too. Or when you have children, you start to know these books. This I have to say. It's called Muffy, I think. But I make the picture of this booklet because it was interesting. For me, it's not the content, but almost the layout as an object, or how the first what is rond, what is around. How the first page is an opening and you see the next. So in this way, to work with layers, with these different layers, and maybe this is also how the lecture is built up. I think I'm gonna quite brief. I have 240 slides to show, so I will pass by the several slides and to notice some small characteristics which are for us important. So we selected, as I told you, several themes. And one of them is suburban nature, or how you go from the big scale to the small scale during the lecture. And this is a lecture. This is an intervention in the forest in Hilversum, in the Netherlands, of Krijn de Koning, an artist which we are using often in our work. Or how you confrontate, in fact, or how you confrontate. Greenery with artificial with mass, how you confrontate stone with green, or soft and hard, and in fact all these components they are ingredients from a city, and this was in fact the starting moment of the project Urban Metamorphosis, or our Winning Europan project, a project which is located immediately in the center, and when you see there is the border, is the city center is let's say going until here, urban context, suburban context. So the team was here how to deal with this transition, a transition in this way, not a physical transition, but a transition of experience, or how we are, or how you try to treat with housing typologies just on this border of transition between the commercial city center, which is existing out of almost 1 euro shop streets and stone profiles, and immediately have this quite green character. And this was one of these, and nowadays you see them often in magazines, these green facades. But what we were doing is not making, let's say, spread out over the plot several houses, but we were making, in fact, two courtyards, and in this way we were not making here architecture. At the end, the result is our buildings, but we were designing, in fact, these two courtyards. And this snake, this S-shape building is in fact, the result is, and is even, a conclusion of this urban pockets. So what you try to do in such an urban situation is to give open space back to the persons who are living there, and even more to invite neighbors to enjoy this greenery as a transition between urban context and suburban environment. Another one is Hybrid Flows, or an European competition, European 8, when I remember me good, in Cordoba. And in fact, there was the same. We had there the same problem, or problem, maybe not a problem, but the same situation. How you treat with this this highway, which it's reaching you to Madrid, and how you treat immediately with this quite low but really dense social area, bordered by this famous river Rio in Cordoba. And in fact, what I show you is a little bit the layout. The layout is again with playing with distance between open space, higher elements, low elements, or how you treat with kind of how building slabs coming closer and farther to each other, and in this way how light and shadow is almost designing the layout of the open space. This is something about the houses, but what I want to show is in fact this picture. This famous picture or this commercial since the 50s, 60s, when I'm good, from this Osborne commercials, this came a kind of issue to start, and this was in one time also the billboard. The how you treat urban landscape, dealing with scale. And when you see this as an artifact, when you see this as an object in landscape, it's like a fact. But when you're gonna treat these ones together with these ones, or when you make a relation, you're gonna build opposite or in front of a building another one, it start to be interesting. So the dialogue between the several buildings is for us the theme here. Besides, it was another theme which we in fact, what, and this is saying this one, we were almost not designing the houses, which is a theme when you make an urban competition or inventing, maybe reinventing new typologies. What we did, we took two almost in architecture archetypes, Atelier of Le Corbusier in Paris, but also the first, let's say, loft by Andy Warhol, or since this period, he used his factory where he was started with his paintings and his objects. Friends came, and I have this feeling, I think, when I entered here, I really liked this space as an office. Nowadays, it's daily stuff, but we use it, in fact, this as archetypes and to bring further these ideas of the loft. Last, I'm gonna go to some other Europans. By accident, we have Europan 7, 8, and 9. An Europan in Amsterdam, where you immediately also treat with the scale of with the scale of Amsterdam. And important is when you see to Amsterdam, I'm thinking immediately on London. And the difference are on Paris, but in London is a better example. London, when you have the Thames, both sides of the Thames, they are almost equal. We have both urban life in London. The river is passing by, but it's not cutting the city in two pieces. One rich side of the city where urban life is, and the rest where often you have low class. In Amsterdam, there you see this example, and in fact you have when you see here, good, I see here the little bit the layout of the canals, these famous canals, but they are also physically and still today, and I think blocked by this monumental building, the station building, of a really nice building of Kapers, but still they have this physical barrier to the other side, in this case the north side of Amsterdam. And the location is something like this. So, but in other side it's giving also immediately potential, and it's not necessary anymore to live beside these urban borders. But nowadays, when these social locations, they are giving inspiration, they are inviting you to make new shapes of life. Often this is activated by artists in the Netherlands, in Dutch we call this een broedplaats, or a place where artists started and maybe 10 years later, this one famous one is coming or was there, and then the galleries are coming in, and 15 years later you have a hot spot and everybody want to live there. So this is a little bit the story here. So how I think in the future this north side of Amsterdam is becoming interested, and this was also for us a team to activate it. So in this way we were almost translating literally a piece of city with a high density, with vistas, with corridors, with high and low buildings, with inner courts, but also with always the visual relation, spatial relation to the environment, and in this case water environment. So again, in fact, often, and this is like a red line we see often in our work when we talk about big scale projects, big scale housing projects. At the end, and this is something we conclude. We are making more open space, an open space for public urban life, and let's say the housing mass is feeding this. Feeding this open space. When we are making the jump and we are coming to Spain, into 2006 we were making a competition for a medical science campus in Granada. And this was in this moment the second project we did in Granada. We made it also a competition for Federico Garcia Lorca Institute, which in fact was much more difficult to do because it was in the city center of Granada. And Granada is for me a really interesting city because in one time, but also with a lot of a complex feeling. As you enter this city, immediately you're feeling the pressure of the history on your shoulders. And everything what you're adding is almost too much. So in this approach we started. Now this project is faced also. I think it's just you see it out of the urban context, but just within the infrastructure. So this is a kind of when you write a sentence. And the only choice we had to make here was, what are we doing? We are writing the sentence, and the sentence is coming out of the city, and you can finish with a point, or you can finish with a question mark, or even an interrogation mark. Besides the problematics of this plot, it was immediately the scale of the plot. And when I remember me, it was 120 meter by almost 1 kilometer. So what we did, we used it literally almost the density of this city, or how you can. It's a difficult question you ask for yourself. How, when you build in Granada, you have to make a Granada building. Or in this way, we used in fact the urban fabric, the urban. Layout as a system, and we started to project several schemes which we found out of the city. We started to project these ones in the plot, and at the end it was not making us this urban plan, but later on you will see when you see to the floor plans of the medical building, the university buildings itself, it was almost making the floor plans literally. So in this way, to one parameter to stay really close to the city, and to project to translate is almost literally. There is one slide which has a problem. So I want okay. Thank you. We have, I think, a slow computer because. Yeah, now it's escape or alt delete. Okay. Yeah. So I skipped one slide, and this is a final image of. Of this proposal for Granada. When we are going back to Belgium, and this is one of these competitions, one of these 5%. So as I told you, where we have next week the confirmation or the signing the contract to build, is a transport. Educating centrum in the border, bordered by France, and nowadays you see often the Belgian location, the geographical location of Belgium in the center of Europe is asking a lot of persons with this experience in transport. So this was in fact the question to make this design. This competition we won. It was an invited competition by the Flemish government. But then when you do these competitions. And when you see this is the second phase, this is the actual building. It's a building of around 6,000 square meters. You have also to deal with the whole infrastructure around. And we came as young architects almost like a surprise. And it was like a kind of, first you have to prove yourself. We had to start with dealing with this part, are making first 20,000 square meter of infrastructure, are let's say a training plot for this center, and then you are confronted with such a machines, which I never saw in my life, because the earth ground was really bad. And they had to add, I don't know even the word in English, I think it's calco. Because you need 110 megapascal force. These are unfortunately not the last pictures, but this is finished. But in fact, some details like how you make, really. A concrete field of 60 by almost 180 meters, so with the several joints. And in fact, it came again a landscape project. How this project we saw it like a technical cut in landscape, and this was quite strange process. So we had, it was almost like not an architectural part, but it was almost like a civil engineering commission. And then it costed in the beginning a lot of input to make yourself enthusiast. And you're asking yourself, what is the question? But at the end, you discover, and this is this, you discover this by confronted scale 1-to-1 or visiting on site, how, for example, such a plateau, such an urban, such a concrete plateau is confronted by the topographical conditions of the location, but how these trees are working like a decor, and how how you have this artificial landscape in combination with some greeneries, which at the end are dominating the views. When we go one step higher and you see, we call it architectural nature. It's an image from a bodega we visited in Jerez. I think the name is bodega González Bias, also where you have one building which is made by Gustav Eiffel. And this picture, I think we are using it really often in several competitions, or how you make this corridor or this transition between two buildings became by vegetation a kind of patio. And these images, the quality of this image, how this vegetation is treating the light, of patios. When I was talking about urban scale of making open spaces, in fact, this chapter is talking about an architectural space by making patios by making patios which is surrounded by architectural by mass, by floor plans. And I think you see it really good in this. It was a small competition, an invited competition for a small museum in Malaga. We were asked to renovate this building. And immediately when you enter this building, you discover this super nice patios and what is in fact the DNA of this building, the spatial condition of this building. And the client had the ambition to even to show this kind of paintings, going from Miró to Picasso, but also Munoz, Iglesias, and Dalí. And the question was not only to treat the front building, this typical patio building, so where you enter, I don't have to explain it, but where you enter and immediately have this patio. What we were doing was in fact only adding two extra patios. And even literally, you have here the sequence of the patio and the stair. We were adding here a patio and a stair and a patio and a stair. And beside this intervention, we were receiving these spaces, and this immediately these spaces, they get some several heights. Where this was in the idea to show paintings, here we could host more actual forms of art by sculpture and video installations. So in this way, again, by not designing these spaces, but designing almost on the architectural scale context, you receive these spaces. And the same was the same day when we visited this bodega in Jerez, we visited also the plot in Cadiz, where the question was to make a school for art, and it was when we visited this plot, this was the first image we discovered. Later on, we went to the city center, the historical city center. And in fact, this plan is saying already a lot about how you treat with streets, but streets which are narrow, like here, and you have open spaces which are can read like patios. And in fact, the building is not more than this, or is a kind of mechanism of patios where a grid is designed. And this grid is I think it's these rhombos. They are not because we like this shape, but they have the the quality of becoming wider and smaller, and which immediately is treating you, is giving you another perception of space, but especially of shadow and light. Of course, in this way, the program was assisting us, but at the end, what we tried to reach was this kind of intermediary between inside and outside, or how you are designing patios, trying to look for a kind of quality in the patios by having light, by having by protecting yourself against the sun. And I think for a school building, is this one of the most important issues when you make open space. And when you come again and to this, and when we focus again to this Granada building, where we not only make the urban plan, but we are making also a proposal for the building of medicine. And as you saw in the urban plan, we projected immediately this urban layout, urban fabric to the situation. Later on, we discovered and we used it, in fact, as a kind of grid for the architectural plans, or how these first models, which they don't have even functions, or this is literally the open and closed spaces, and the density is going up. And this was also in one time the translation of the program, where you have down the public space, the meeting space for students. When you go one step higher, you have the public auditorias, and at the end, at the last floor, at the last floors, you have these investigation rooms for docents and persons who are making their thesis, which is in fact not public. And in this way, we discovered this density you find in a city like Granada came almost immediately planned for a building in Granada. One or two slides. And in this way, you see here the first image from the main floor, how open space is immediately the almost reflections of the characteristics of the city. And when you go up, you discover this density, which of course is influenced by this part of the city. And then the next step is how you translate this section, not only by the using literally this density of city, but also the characteristics of the city, and how you treat facade, how you treat light, how you treat space. But I will come back later in the presentation. Next chapter is green and stone, or the duality between soft and hard, as almost like a building brick in making space. And when we go to a Dutch project, a housing project, which is now recently commissioned, and I have to say we changed totally the layout. But what we were doing in fact is, and when you know, this is a typical, they call it post-war urban plan. It's a plan of the 50s, immediately after the Second World War. And they were in fact using this kind of slabs, four or five layered high buildings without elevators, entrances on the outside, and this greenery is only greenery which you are using to see, without any social activity, By other hand, we tried to enforce this, and in fact what we were doing, we were making a stone plateau to enter immediately the stone plateau, not to make the entrances from these houses on the outside, but on the inside, so that you have your greenery, your green environment, and this like an entrance room as a kind of transition between inside and outside to activate a little bit the, we called it, you can also call it almost like a room without roof, or how you make maybe here in Spain a kind of you make an extra large patio, and where you meet your neighbor, and where you have where you make some contacts. So it was in fact this. And these skins, they are now, when I'm explaining them, I'm asking myself, they are so simple and so evident, but it's almost a whole story, and in one way 3 years discussing to get this layout, because in the Netherlands everybody want to build in the Netherlands, but when you are making housing project in the Netherlands, you are dealing with such a conservative clients, and that's just in fact the theme of this of these commissions is making from a banal commission in fact architecture. An open space which is influenced by this Swiss example. And then even you go further and you translate this green environment is get even when you see between inside and outside this green glass or this green glass protection of the balconies, which is then immediately also a reference to artists. Another project, but is in fact based with on the same strategy. And later on, one of the members of the jury, he was saying, "You are winning this competition because we had to make this urban plan." And I was talking here about a Spanish plaza. And Patricia, she was really angry with me. Don't explain this as a Spanish plaza. In Spain, we have much more quality, and don't. So at the end, 1 week later, we discovered that there was the project was presented in a newspaper, and they talked it about the location is Berlaar. In Berlaar, they receive Spanish plazas. So this is the influence of our maybe my Spanish. Ambition of enthusiasm, but by other hand, it's also a little bit a strategy or selling your product, because everything that's coming from the south is good. Or when you go to the north, you're coming back, but when you're going to the south, it's more difficult to go back. And in this way, it's also playing of again this green and stone. This layout of stones and green, and by accident, by making this infrastructure, in one time came this in the center of this urbanization came this green open field, which is also now the environment or the quality of this project. So maybe I'm repeating myself, but this is in fact, when you look back and when you're designing, you're intuitively, you're using different projects, and again, it's designing space. But in one time, it's also it's designing open space. But in one time, this is also let's say a condition of a competition. Because of course you want to design details, but I think with the detail in a competition you don't win. So finally, and later on I will show you some details. But this is in fact to a base of how to treat facades. When we go to, and I think this is the fourth chapter, we are still treating with this urban characteristics, and I think this is something which you daily discover by walking in the street. And often, when you walk in the street, and this I'm always explaining to my students, you have to discover space and not only to look in these shop windows and looking for clothes, but discover profiles, discover what is a square in a city, how is this square made. And in fact, this was a little bit the starting point, or how we use this artist reference from Anish Kapoor, also an artist which we are looking often to. And I think some year ago he made a wonderful project. It's not in the lecture, but he made a wonderful project in Chicago. So you have to Google it. But this was in fact a little bit the base of this new commission we received. So the European Commission is until now was located here, and we don't have a commission for it, but we received another plot, even a more important location, and this is on the main entrance road of the city, where immediately you have to treat with other conditions. Where before we were saying we're gonna make a kind of enclosed gardens, enclosed outside space, we were going here one step back, but also one step in a higher scale, or what we were trying to do. What we are trying to do is not only making space for the immediately environment of houses, but giving this space which the location is bordered by this, by a small brook and some infrastructure. In fact, what we were trying to do was making the space between these blocks, and you have to see that every block is around 30 houses. A distance, a plot of 20 meter open space. So in this way, we tried to make a rich open space above a parking place to attract these entrances for this housing project. This we are, let's hope, still developing, and we are, let's say, not monthly, but a few times a year, we are sitting to discuss with the mayor and everybody who is important in Hengelo, still to make from this a project. Because you have to know, this is the second or the third version of Europan, but in fact, this project is 100% based on the enthusiasm of the office. And in fact, this then the client is calling, and maybe you can do something, because maybe we can have a meeting with the mayor. So this is maybe already the fifth free proposal, but I think it's worth to continue and constantly fighting for these commissions. But when you see this change of several projects, in one time they became interesting, and it's in the office always when I try to make person enthusiast, I'm always saying you have to make from nothing something, or how a competition, how can a lost competition the source for another competition, and in this case it came. We used it, in fact, what we learned from this urban composition. We were invited for a restricted competition for a school building, or how we were using this strategy of making open space making the playgrounds for the children. And in fact, the playgrounds for the children became the issue any one time. Are the class, the buildings which have here the classrooms, and also the other buildings with sport facilities, are in fact zoning the several outside spaces, so the main playground, the playground for the small children. By this open space, in one time this building came a transition between this street and this street, and this back facade came front facade, because this came the new entrance, and beside this for sport facilities, you could organize the outside playing fields. And then what you're trying to do is to try to, because clients, they are not interested in this, because this is something which is evident and which you do in 2 minutes, but you try to translate it with some rich examples out of history, and how the Smithsons and the Smithsons are used, or how we are using the Smithsons not for architecture but especially for urbanism. And the most important and nice building, I think, is this three towers of the Economist building in the center of London. You have these three towers, but when you enter this development, how this in such a crowded place of London, what kind of quality you can find back is for me a big influence of the Smithsons. But also, and this, you can find out. This project was also done a few months after we were doing Granada, and then you are coming back, and then you find this artist by Adrian Cheese, but also how we were using. So in this way, often you see there are some graphical plans, and this is what I learned from an urbanist in the Netherlands. His name is Ton Schaap. I was doing with him some urban projects, and he was always explaining a good plan is also looking graphically good. So this is an input, but also how you use a tree is a leaf and a leaf is a tree. This shifting by scale, a house is a city and a city is a house, a tree is a tree, but it's also a Huck leaf. Such a things which you find back with Aldo van Hek, but I think I don't have to, I will pass by. When you go, and I think the lecture is built up by scale. When you go one step farther, and we are also one step closer by buildings, by architectures, and often and this is not a promotion for the office, but often I'm saying to clients, we are still making urban plans, or we are still making open spaces, and because you have to make them first, or you have to not make them first physically, but you have to know first what is the environment, what is the open space around the building, to be able to start designing, to be able to start detailing a building in itself. And this is in fact this the characteristics. And again, when you look, and now I'm talking about this training center, where in the beginning I was showing you this training infrastructure, civil engineering project. This is the second phase, where we have this. This is the training lot, and here we're gonna start building now this building. But how are you using again this knowledge of landscape? This knowledge of landscape to design this building, and where we used this horizontal character of the context, but also the vertical character. Or how you can see how, and this image will come back later, how you treat these facades. And when you see, this is 40 meter by 100 meter. And there's not only the question of making the detail, but first, again, this scale, how you treat a facade of 100 meter, and how, what is the attitude of this facade in the landscape? So in this way, there is a complementary or a contradiction between the front facades, so these ones and these ones, which is in fact the facades which are bordering immediately the public functions, the functions which you see here in the front and the back. So you have all the administrations and the teaching zones in the front and in the back. And like how you use two blocks or two massive stones to press things together. These effects are used to make the to make this big, this big inside training, inside space, which, and this is also in this way explained it to the structural engineer why these slabs and these slabs are almost necessary to build such an space. Because you have problems with wind and etc. Or how we could it's a span of 40 meter which will be made in 75 centimeter height. So we could make here 75 centimeter, which is almost extreme low, by using this, let's say, almost contra elements. You don't need crosses against wind, etc. And it's almost pure the span, and the rest of the influences for structural influences are made in the scheme of the building in the front and in the back. And this is how you try, and we try immediately to go further. We try to make architecture is in one time making structure or installations are working together with architecture. This is for us an important part of investigation, but also literally where you use this kind of buffers as acoustical buffers, where you use these buffers like zones for installations, etc. But also when you go further and when you go back to Spain, we were invited for a competition some years ago in Estepona, a theater, where in fact, and these are choices you have to make. I think the winning scheme was made by David Chipperfield, and here we made it. I show you these images. This is the environment, and this is the building. And the first sentence of the brief, of the competition brief was, you have to bring the building to the sea. So my first idea was, okay, then I'm gonna make this building there. So in one way, we were going, of course, when you ask this in a competition brief, it has a certain reason, but then you don't have to give this plot. So we were, in fact, totally ignoring this question. But it's also later on you saw also that we lost for this reason. Or how we were making not this physical relation between the sea and this building, but we were making in this way this building so special, and we treated like almost like an object in itself. an object which is asking so much attention, and in the way of almost the aura of the building is catching the city, is trying to establish a relation with the city. So by just pointing out not to make this relation with the seaside. And in this way, it was really, really, really direct. But I have to go to this image. It was also the period the Picasso Center in Malaga was opened, and I discovered this, for me, one of the nicest sketches of Picasso, where he started, I think, the 28th of November, and this 28th of November 58, and this is the 6th of January 59, and in a sequence of several days, he made this sketch of these sketches of a Toro, or how you can, by making everything, by doing, by repeating, by using it every time again, the same but different, or how Patricia is always saying, and she learned it from Moneo, and Moneo is saying always, you have to say always the same but different. So how every sequence is going, and for me, this is saying even more than maybe this. So this was almost literally this influence, or making an object which could be so strong and so autonomous that it could ignore the context, but just by curving the facades, making again space, but then literally making space for the aura of the building, making space for the entrance and for the public functions like a bar, etc. And the same you find back with this project, or how the client was coming to us, and he had a house in a typical Flemish environment. And what he discovered, or what we later translated, it was how you can use these building regulations, and by you have this maximal building plot, and you're gonna translate it. It's almost like to make a sculpture, and using context. Parameters to make context with the garden and to answer to the border, because you have to make, there is a certain distance to the border, and how you disposition a building beside another building. But also, and we could only continue with this project when we discovered this art piece of Olaf Ureliasson, or how this big stone is giving a certain lightness, not only to the building but also to the stone, or how you can add something near an existing building. And at the end, they are coming in this way by not making the object in itself, but because often you treat it like we make some models, but these models are not. Making these models are not made by finding the shape. These models are, in fact, to find the confirmation that the strategy of making this joyful jewel, this object, is a good strategy. And even in this way, we were going farther. And this was also a period, the first year of the office, where Patricia and I. We were working with the two of us, and then you can do such things like you make a wooden model to look for the composition and the qualities of this object. You're making a plexi model to find out how could work the program and to make a model of concrete. To make a model of concrete to discover materialization. And then you see also how we learned from this model, this quite simple model, which you have here in the middle, how you can make this open space. Because one time I was explaining him the story of the loft, so the open, endless space, but still to answer to the question of his children, to give them each their own room. We transformed it and we were building two rooms on top of this open space. I have to say this was a project which we developed until the execution drawings. But then something happened, or what's happened? This guy is divorced 20 years ago, and out of his relation he had two children. And since 1 year and a half he has a new relation. And his new relation, his new wife, probably she had another ambition or another way of living, and she totally ignored and blocked this project. So today you have this discussion of changing families by divorcing, but when also somebody new is coming in, it's giving often problems. This is I think one of, until now, the only project which is commissioned immediately from a private client, and this is not even not going on. I was when you go back, and we are jumping again back to Spain, so we are jumping to between Spain and Belgium. I told you we were making a competition for Granada, or how you make in the shadow of this impressionant building, you have to make a building. Or how you treat with this urban fabric, and as I told you, an urban environment where in every street the history and culture is pushing on your shoulders, and even I was confused what I have to do here. And in fact, to give answer to this project, we came back and we didn't stay in Granada, but we were visiting for 1 week in Paris. And this is the atelier of Brancusi, famous artist, which was a student from Rodin. And maybe to explain this image, this atelier is located immediately near the Centre de Pompidou. And in fact, what we discovered is everybody knows today this atelier because it's immediately located. It's a kind of, it's not a dependence, but it's when you go to the Centre Pompidou, often you can enter this building. Or in the other way around, this building is meaning for Brancusi, how this atelier makes his work, or what was the meaning of this building for Centre Pompidou in the other way around. So we tried it not to find out a meaning for the Lorca as a building, and I think in this way it was evident that you find the influence of Lorca by his own poetry. Where, of course, he had this given program. I think this I skip because I want to tell you something, and this, because this is another theme of this Joyful Jewels. I want to finish with the last chapter, and we call this skin and surface. So we come again one step closer to architecture, or to developing a building, or how you treat a facade. Floor plans we saw already by influence by urban fabric. But treating a facade is not only making holes in a facade and looking that light is coming in and that you make a relation between inside and outside. But often, and this again we were learning by looking, for example, to this painting of Helmut Federle. How you can see a facade in several ways, and one theme of a facade is a kind of a composition or a constellation of surfaces. or how this small building is made. You can almost see it like it's a three-dimensional chest pattern. The chest pattern we used in Berlaar is translated here in architecture, or how you treat with open facades and closed facades. Of course, and the difficulty is how you make such a joint where this is open and this is open. So this is one of these buildings we are now developing for, because this is a small building of this training center. And at the end, the solution we have is, when this is concrete, we have here an inox frame, which is immediately making this this cross. But also for this school building, when you go farther, and this is not a facade, but this is volume, and this is again a view of this Crème de Koning. How you treat with surface, but also surface has a certain thickness. And this thickness we call tectonic, or how you you can use the facade as a the thickness of the facade is making not only the architecture, but it's also making the atmosphere in the spaces behind. And when, of course, you can learn out of history a lot of these issues. But how you treat in a really simple way that an entrance, you give a facade a thickness of half or almost 80 centimeters, and here you go to 40, and here you go to zero. And so in this way, you describe also that the ritual of entering this building by the thickness of the facade. And this is immediately and is affected with the shadow. Or what, again, when you look to Ronchon, Corbusier, I don't have to explain it. So these are all, in fact, studies on that the facade is thicker than paper. Another aspect, and finally we are coming to the point of one of these buildings which we are developing now, this training center. And I told you that we were we had this landscape, how you make a facade of 100 meter in the landscape. First we go to this Cadiz school, but I show you some images and I'm gonna give the explanation in the last project. I think this is the most interesting. So this building you saw with horizontal front facade and the vertical side facades, and or how you make a building in landscape, or how this rows of trees is the building for this landscape, where we make that this building which is, as I told you, 40 by 100 meter, or how you treat it between this, the horizontality and the verticality. And when you look good, we used, in fact, these curtains, these transparent curtains as an influence, or how this is materialized in inox, in acero, and this is materialized in architectural precasted concrete. This is using the characteristics of the material by its own. Shiny, when it's wet, is getting another texture, another reflection than when it's sunny. And in the opposite way of thinking, we were making here, in fact, a precasted element. And this precasted element existing out of one material, but just reshaping this element, and making these shapes in this sandwich panel is giving you shadow and light. are these are mockups scale 1 to 2, which are now in the office, and how you see that by using in fact light is making your architecture, because light is making shadow. And this was the image which I showed you here, is in fact a little bit inspiration. Or Patricia is coming then back with such an images, and then she's saying we're going to make a facade like this, and then most of the time I don't understand. And 2 weeks later, she's coming with such an impression, and then she's always saying, yeah, but we are building in Spain, we are building with light. And this is, in fact, my story of building with light. Until models scale to 1 to 20 of the facade. I have still some time. And as a last chapter, I have, in fact, 2 chapters more. And this is a chapter which I introduced, in fact, in the university in Delft. It's called, beside I'm teaching that architectural designing or making designing projects, I'm also teaching architectural studies. And as Jorge explained during the introduction, the Netherlands is nowadays, and it's still, it's Colas, it's Winimaas, it's a building with one concept. And Tony Fredner was asking me one day, like, how we can. It's like more the how we can give an answer to this almost dogmatic way of thinking of students. So what I proposed are with our team is to come really close to buildings which we know out of history. But we are selecting just one team, and by selecting this one team, you discover that the building is built out of maybe 10, 20 ideas, which I explained to you during the introduction. So this is, for me, in fact, this teaching on the university, it changed also my way of looking to actual buildings, looking to history. So just pointing out. And it's not studying history of this project, but it's studying several themes to understand these 99 other themes of this building, which is making this building. Yeah, and now the first building is this typical. It's one element of this water hydraulic building in Madrid by Fisac. Or how we compared it, this Fisac with the Kunsthal of OMA. And OMA, everybody is talking about this transition on the urban scale between the street and the park, which is behind the building. But in fact, when one time you enter the building and you have a really nice constellation and routing through the building, is not only made by this one scheme which is making the routing, but is even made by how you discover, how you read spaces, or how spaces are lighted up by this super complex and in one time also a genius solution of the roof, which you can also find back with this building of Isaac. Another one, when you compare this Barcelona pavilion of Mies, how he is using the materials in the walls, and how Aalto is using materials in floor and ceiling, but also how Aalto is using a column. So you can already make a whole essay about the column of Mies and the column of Aalto. Some communication of Coderre and Ponti, but when you see the Pirelli building, which is in Milano, and out of the same period of this housing project in Barceloneta of Coderre. You could also compare it with the Paris housing building of Herzog de Meuron. Or how are structural interventions in a city making urban space this Museum of Lina Bobardi, which is made, this span of 75 meter is made by, or is necessary by the infrastructure and how Moretti is building in the city. The comparison of Diener and Terragni. But you can also go, you can also see it literally, the first proposal for the for the Tate to compare it with Fizak. And these are themes which we are studying with students. Maybe the last one, the church, a building of Leverens in Stockholm. And when you see through the eyes that the texture of the trees is almost the texture of the brickworks. Or how Herzog de Meuron is using the earth, which is founded back in the plot of this building by itself. And as last, I want to show you one builded project, and this is an exhibition in the Singel. A few years ago, we were invited by the art center in the Singel to make a small intervention, and we were proposing this black box, and this black box we were not adding to the exhibition space, but we were adding to the corridor which is leading you to the exhibition space to search for the tension between the characteristics of this slope. So the container, the black container, is almost balancing on this slope, and the exhibition was existing out of one horizontal line of super small picture, 5 by 7 centimeters of our projects. It's a kind of chain, and the idea was you can enter this container, and in fact you can start where you want. 5 by centimeters to look close, because in this container you don't have the space to take distance, so you have to go close. And the last exhibition was a proposal, but it was a not winning competition for the Architecture Biennale, the Architectural Biennale in Venice, last November. Or how you use the Scarpa Blue in, again, the container. Of course, the influence of the churches of Palladio. This is not a work of Palladio, but how cladding of a room is making the spatial conditions, spatial qualities of a space. And this we were almost translating literally by this Scarpa Blue. Left side, a church of Palladio, or how you use this in your work. Voilà. So, in fact, what I was trying to explain today, and I hope you will invite us. Let's say in 2 or 3 years, then I will show you builded projects. And I was, in fact, showing you the kitchen of an office who is making competitions and is now opening the door to start building it. Mejor hasta primero una cerveza y después empieza con la...